Orations are special occasions where lectures and speeches are given by persons of eminence, and they often receive standing ovation. So it's a matter of great honor and privilege that Dr. D. L. Anjavar is with us today, and he is a part of the faculty member. And in general, we all must be benefited directly or indirectly because of the interactions and sojourn he has with us. Today he is delivering, he is actually repeating Dr. C. I. Jhala Oration, which he has delivered in the international
PJ Chandigarh
conference held in PJ Chandigarh. Now, usually there is some ceremonial function where orations are given, and he will be telling you how he has done it. And at least I will love to listen to you. You are invited.
1 minute, sir.
Yes.
A word for Dr. C. I. Jhala Sahib.
Sir, सामने आ
सर यार इट्स अ छोटी सी बात है सर. His son was probably resident doctor in surgical branch in VS hospital. He was doing his post graduation and he acquired infection hepatitis B. In those days, autoclaving was not so popular. All syringes were reused and they were used only after boiling. This was going on in many government and corporation hospitals and all over Gujarat. This was a practice. And his life was sacrificed for the doctors could not save him. But with these incidents, autoclaving and disposable needles era came. Thanks to his son, that's a great sacrifice of Dr. C. I. Jhala. Just for the sake of, when I read his name, I go, let us mention his son's name.
So good afternoon, everyone. Now, as you have been hearing this name, Dr. C. I. Jhala, sir, he was a very eminent pathologist who served as the professor and head of the department at the VJ Medical College, Ahmedabad. Later, he was also the dean and superintendent at M.P. Shah Medical College, Jamnagar. He passed away in 2012. Now, because of his immense work and contribution to the field of pathology and bacteriology, the Indian Academy of Pathologists, they have started an oration, which will be mostly an annual oration, and starting from this year. So we are fortunate that Dr. Langevar sir was chosen for this oration, the first ever oration, the C. I. Jhala Oration. And we will be hearing the success story of our pathologist, that how the dreaded disease of polio has been now eradicated from our country. So I invite Dr. D. Langevar sir to deliver this talk.
Thank you very much. And good evening. Since 1999 to 2011, either as a secretary of Indian Association of Pathologists and Microbiologists or as a president of Indian Association of Pathologists and Microbiologists or as a secretary of Indian College of Pathologists, I was closely associated with Dr. C. I. Jhala. And the most important reason for this association was that roots of both of us were linked to the pathology department of Grand Medical College, Mumbai. During these 12 years, he was a guide and father figure for me. And therefore, it is a matter of great honor and pride to deliver an oration on the name of a person with whom you had such a long association. In this oration, I shall be presenting to you India's journey in a period prior to establishment of nationwide polio immunization. Sara family is one of the few families of the pathologist. Dr. H. I. Jhala is an elder brother of Dr. C. I. Jhala. Postgraduate student, Grand Medical College, Mumbai, he was head there. Subsequently, he became director of prestigious institute, Hopkins Institute, Mumbai. Dr. C. I. Jhala, undergraduate and postgraduate student of Pathology Department of Grand Medical College, Mumbai. He worked there as assistant professor, then moved to BJ Medical College, Ahmedabad. He became head dean. Dr. Niraj Jhala is the son of Dr. C. I. Jhala. Dr. Darshana Jhala is the wife of Dr. Niraj Jhala. Both are well-known, internationally acclaimed pathologists. They are serving in Temple University, Philadelphia, United States of America. Both these senior Jhalas, they have witnessed a first milestone of polio research that was laid down in 1949 in the Pathology School of Grand Medical College, Mumbai. They themselves were involved with research in the poliomyelitis. And therefore, they were knowing success stories of this investigation not only in Mumbai, but those happening in the country as well as around the globe. I believe some of these stories are told by them in a family to Dr. Niraj Jhala, and therefore they have decided that these success stories should be brought to the notice of younger generation of doctors. Therefore this oration was kept. A plan of my talk will be like this. In the beginning, a brief introduction to the topic will be given. This will be followed by discussion of some epidemic which happened in pre-independent India. Then there will be extensive discussion on polio epidemics in India, the work done by ICMR virus unit, and while working with this, some international cooperations were also developed. And in the end, summarizing and concluding remarks will be presented. This is a story of our fathers and grandfathers in pathology. Their qualification was MD in pathology and bacteriology. Extensive work has been done by them in the last 5 decades. Covering epidemiology, pathogenesis, pathology, vaccine efficacy, and so on. And because of this, they were able to harness this crippling disease from our country. How they have done this will be presented to you. Several epidemics of numerous magnitude started to appear in the developed countries in the beginning of 20th century. They were seen in United States of America, United Kingdom, other European countries, Russia, and so on. Only one example I am showing it to you. Epidemics that happened in and around the New York City from 1907 to 1952. several thousand children became crippled because of this epidemic. Several thousand children succumbed to this epidemic. The epidemic had very special characteristic. Child was there, normal, playing in a house, going to school. Next day, child becomes crippled. Crippled for entire life. No parents in this globe had experienced such type of phenomena prior to this. Parents all over the globe were frightened. The minds of scientists were shattered. But they conquered it after 6 decades. All these developed countries eliminated poliomyelitis in their countries after 6 decades. Let us now go to the Indian scenario. No epidemics of poliomyelitis were observed in our country before 1947. After 1947, there were some epidemics. And the serious epidemic was in this period, 1970 to 1990. 2 lakhs to 4 lakh children were crippled annually in this 20 years. It amounts to paralysis of 500 to 1000 cases per day. And then subsequently, it also took several years for us, 70 years. And the last case of poliomyelitis in this country was identified on January 13, 2011 in Howrah district of West Bengal. And therefore, on March 27, 2014, World Health Organization declared India polio free. It was a successful moment. All of us were happy, doctors were happy, pediatricians were happy, parents were happy. We celebrated this, but how it was celebrated? This success was because of a collective efforts of government and non-government organizations, national and international agencies, celebrities, print media, audiovisual media, doctors, social workers, nurses, medical students and so on. But when this success came, only few figures were remembered. Many people or many hands who served for this immunization, many minds who worked day and night to control this poliomyelitis were forgotten. Our pathologists were in this forgotten group. Today I am showing you their faces. I am also enumerating some names who had contributed significantly for this epidemic. Let us now look into this important phenomena, epidemics in pre-independent India. 4 epidemics occurred before independence. Number 1, Asiatic cholera epidemic, 1870 to 24. Plague epidemic, 1896 to 97. Influenza epidemic, 1980 to 1990. Several million people died, and because it was a pre-independent India, Britishers used to invite European bacteriologists to investigate and control this epidemic. These were the great persons, Hafkin, Robert Koch, Surveyor, Hankin, Manser and Pitchford. They all visited in pre-independent area to control this epidemic. Investigate this epidemic. Now tell me, when we become independent, do we have a facility to invite them? Is Indian government going to invite them? No. Because it was a British government, they could invite. And therefore, after independence, the responsibility came on the shoulder of Indian pathologists. How they have done this, I shall be narrating to you shortly. Which were the research institute in those days? Only 4 research institutes were available in India in pre-independent era. This 1891 Ramji Dinsha Petit Laboratory at the Grand Medical College, Mumbai. 1899 Hopkins Institute, Mumbai. 1904 Central Research Institute, Kasauli. 1907 Pasteur Institute, India, Kunnur, Tamil Nadu. And only one organization was there, 1911. Indian Research Fund Association, which was renamed as ICMR in 1949. Out of these 4, these 3 in black color, they were established by British government. And this by an Indian citizen, Ramji Dinsha Petit. A Parsi community man, businessman, philanthropist, but visionary. Despite a businessman, he had a vision to develop this laboratory. He constructed this. He set apart 75,000 rupees for construction of this, and it was constructed in 60,242 rupees. Such an example of completion of any project within the budgeted amount is not seen in modern India. Room number 000, landmark in history of plague. In this room, Dr. Hopkins developed safe and effective plague vaccine. First he injected on himself in front of Dean Grand Medical College, Mumbai. And after his success, it was immunized to millions of Indian population. He saved millions of Indian citizens. Not only in plague, he also had developed cholera earlier, cholera vaccination. And therefore, his contribution was recognized by British government. First, he was honored by giving him CIE, but Indian government also recognized his contribution. Former President of India, Mr. V.V. Giri, unveiled his plaque at the entrance of this building for his contributions of mankind in India. Now let us move to this problem, our problem, taking into consideration the size of the country, large number of population, enormous birth rate, illiteracy and lack of health consciousness. This was the scenario with us 1947, even earlier also. Government of India after independence, they have prioritized these diseases for control. Tuberculosis, malaria, leprosy, kalaza, infantile diarrhea. Poliomyelitis was not targeted as a disease for control because nothing was known about this disease. No one was knowing when it is going to take a bad turn. But it did that. It did it in 3 months after independence. November 12, 1947 to January 15, 1948, 1,043 cases of poliomyelitis were documented in Andaman and Nicobar Island of India, of which 325 died. Several children became crippled. And this was investigated by founder director of ICMR, Dr. C G Pandit. And investigation stopped there. Nothing was done after that. They have identified that it is poliomyelitis, and the reason was very simple. And I am showing you map of India here. This is Andaman and Nicobar. Nowhere it is connected to the mainland of India. And therefore, I shimmer thought that this virus is not going to come out there. Therefore, no investigations were done. And ultimately, this happened. Another landmark in the history of poliomyelitis, 1949. What happened in 1949? Mumbai was in the grip of poliomyelitis for the first time. Line diagram of Mumbai shown here, 1947, orange color, 1949, yellow color. You can look at the spots. These are the spots of poliomyelitis cases. They are few and scattered in 47, the many and close in 1949. A total of 300 cases of poliomyelitis were identified in 1949. That became a problem to ICMR now, because poliomyelitis has come in the mainland. Mumbai was linked to every city of the country. And therefore, they decided to start this polio research unit. Polio research unit of ICMR, the pathology school of Grand Medical College, Mumbai. And the aim of this establishing the unit was to identify the disease, to know factors responsible for epidemic, and to know if virus is imported or it is a localized virus, endemic virus. Old building of Grand Medical College, 1945 shown. During those days, pathology laboratory was located over here. 1929, this building was constructed. It has a ground floor and mezzanine floor occupied by pathology museum, first floor by histopathology laboratory, and second floor by bacteriology laboratory. This was the site, second floor was the site of establishment of this polio research unit. They were given polio research unit, no equipments were given, and this is a routine in India. You get earthquake today, and tomorrow we find solution. If you have a floods today, day after tomorrow we try to think over that. Same thing happened, and they were given without any facility. They started this as a great person, Dr. Purushottam Vishwanath Gharpure, very eminent pathologist, professor and head, 1927. To 1951. He joined pathology department in 1924. With some interruption in this period, because he served in a World War II. He was made officer in charge. He was also president of Indian Association of Pathologists and Microbiologists. So when you have nothing, what you are going to do? So pathologists were moving in the streets of polio-affected area, house to house visit. First job, collecting demographic data, recording paralysis, pattern of paralysis, and noting down mortality. This is the work done by pathologists of this country. Because nothing was known, how to investigate, how to do study. And at that time, they only knew that polio viruses are present in a fecal specimen of poliomyelitis children. Methods of culture were not available, they were not developed. And therefore that we sought on this experimental animal study to produce the same disease as is seen in affected children. So healthy adult monkeys were taken, they were anesthetized, roof of the nose was scrapped to produce minor injury, 10 ml of fecal inoculum was put drip by drip into the nostril for 7 days, the rectal temperature was taken, CSF was examined, they were examined for muscle weakness, paralysis and prostration, just lying down to die. At this stage, they were sacrificed and autopsies were performed. In the autopsies, their brain and spinal cord was preserved in 50% neutral glycerin. This is the media where viruses survive for more than 15 years. They were used for further studies. They were inoculated in other healthy monkeys, rats, mice and embryonic eggs. The same disease was produced in other group of monkeys. And preserved tissue in 10% formalin was used for histopathology, which showed characteristic features of neuronal damage and inflammation, a feature suggestive of poliomyelitis. So disease was produced in animals. It was established that it is poliomyelitis. The second question, while these people were working, they were interacting with international communities. And this is how Dr. P. V. Garpure established a collaboration, Dr. Bodian's poliomyelitis lab in John Hopkins Institute, Baltimore, 64 random sera from adults in Mumbai, they were sent to him because facilities were not available with us. 90% shows neutralizing antibodies to all three types of poliovirus. So they established etiology, but the disease process by which these children were suffering was poliomyelitis. Another history now, another landmark, 1961. Most important landmark in the history of poliomyelitis, because it was the first step of polio eradication in India. And what happened? 13 March 1961, Directorate of Health Services, Andhra Pradesh, he writes a letter to the director of ICMR informing him that in Krishna and Godavari district, in several villages, small children are suffering from paralysis. And therefore, he requests ICMR to send a team for investigation. This is how ICMR unit goes there. They do demographic survey, children below 4 years are affected. Now this in 12 years, they are equipped with the best laboratory facilities. Fecal specimens from 44 children, they showed growth of poliomyelitis type 1. It was confirmed now immediately. And that this time, they decide to plan immunization with trivalent oral polio vaccine. This vaccine was not available in India. Nowhere this vaccine was there. And therefore, it comes to the international cooperation. The first international cooperation of India happened with Russia and Canada after independence. That was on the health issues. And therefore, Russian government, they sent 1 lakh doses of dragis. Dragis are small sugar-coated chocolates. They are to be given to the children. Not possible to give them in the children 3 months to 2 years age. So our pathologists had to devise a method how to introduce this vaccine. Number two, 50,000 doses, they were made available from poliomyelitis laboratory in Toronto, Canada. It was also same collaboration. No one was knowing about vaccination in poliomyelitis. So these people, they took lectures, prepared the literature, distributed the literature, prepared handbill, handbill in Telugu language, distributed the announcement by loudspeaker, press coverage, and first film on polio was produced, INR 660. So health authorities were stimulated, general public was stimulated, identification of immunization centers in villages was carried out, training for administration of vaccine was given, and first dose was given in May 1961 to 59,000 children. Second dose, 36,000 children. Dr. Gharpure and Dr. Dave were regularly visiting these areas. What is the finding in 1962? Existing epidemic was controlled. They saved several thousand children from becoming crippled. This was the work done by pathologists. And it was not one epidemic. Several epidemics were controlled by them. There is another example, small outbreak in 1963, Udaipur. They were also given these doses. In Jaipur city, 25,000 cases. All these vaccine trials were given, and epidemics in this area was controlled. The entire documentation of this polio virus, it was very surprising for me to see these two lines beneath the names of the author. I am going to show them in higher magnification. There is no greater and more important aim a scientist can set himself than helping victory over poliomyelitis. They were written by this Libosi. I thought it has been written by some literary person, but no. This is not Libosi. A Russian doctor, pediatrician, specialist in infectious diseases, and most specialist in poliomyelitis. He was on deputation to Indian government by Soviet government from 1950 to 1955. And what he did, he was teaching resident in pediatric department in Lady Harding Medical College about the infectious diseases and poliomyelitis. It was not only that, they were examining patients in Kalavati Saran Children Hospital, New Delhi. They imported the best physiotherapy equipment in that hospital for treatment of poliomyelitis. This man produced 16 documents for general people in 20 different Indian languages. Such a great contribution. Other activities of polio research units were epidemics in the out. They controlled that. Epidemics in Darjeeling, though this unit was located in Mumbai, it was controlling all the activities in the entire country. Epidemics in Andaman and Nicobar, 47 epidemic. Their samples were preserved. Nobody investigated. The principal researcher, he had preserved those samples. He sent it to Dr. Gharpure in 1957. Those were also investigated. So this is the contribution of polio research unit. These are the people who have contributed significantly. More than 20 papers were published. And these were by Dr. Gharpure, Dr. Dave, Dr. Jhala. There are several others. But only reporting is not important. You have to do something else. Establish rapport with Bombay Municipal Corporation. Because major activity of these investigations were happening in Bombay. Their officers were in Lupful. Bombay was the first corporation where polio immunization started by BMC in the country. One country was not aroused at that time. They discussed with pediatricians, took lectures so that their interest remains in the subject. Data was supplied to ICMR, it was supplied to WHO. 20 strains of polio were donated to United States of America. That was a great contribution, and because of this work, WHO recognized that these persons are helpful. They can go, our country can go into the immunization state, and therefore they were invited to United States of America. Dr. Gharpure and Dr. H. I. Jhala, they were invited to United States of America, Russia, Czechoslovakia, Canada, to see how polio immunization is carried out there. Sabin, who is a developer of this oral polio vaccine, he invited them in Payama County, Tucson, to see their program. And this was an important thing because now country was changing from one scenario to another scenario, wanted to accept this polio immunization. I have already told you that 1970-1990 was a period where there was a tremendous load of poliomyelitis, and therefore ICMR established some more units. One was established in Bangalore, another in Ahmedabad, third in Lucknow, fourth in Nagpur. All these units, they were carrying out similar type of the work on a regional basis. That was done by ICMR unit in Mumbai. And this is the paper then of Dr. C. I. Jhala, on whose name this oration is there. They were trying to give immunization in different doses. Antibody response to 3 doses of conventional, double dose of oral polio vaccine, and to 6 doses of conventional OPV. In 3 doses, type 1 antibody was 87%, 6 doses 100%. This was a learning phenomenon. Antibody type 2, 74%, 3 doses 87%. So as long as you give more doses, the antibody response was much more. Better efficacy after 6 doses. This report was accepted by ICMR for further immunization. Dr. H. I. Jhala, when he was the director of Hopkins Institute, he established a network of poliomyelitis laboratories. There were 8 laboratories in the country. So that if one has a problem, something cannot be done in one laboratory, you can communicate with that. This was also pathologist. There was a great contribution of Dr. H. I. Jhala. And then they visited the United States of America, not only to see what is happening there, but they invited Sabin. This photograph of Sabin with Dr. Gharpure and Dr. Jhala in the lawn of Hopkins Institute in January 1963. And they did not call him just for visit. There was some purpose for that. This purpose I will show you by this slide. I have told you about this institute, Pasteur Institute of India, Kunnur, Tamil Nadu. Some laboratory work was happening there about poliomyelitis. Traditional work was this, 1968. Milestone in history of poliomyelitis. Sabin donated his vaccine strains to this laboratory. He trained this Veera Raghavan and Balasubramanyam to produce polio vaccine. 6 batches of oral vaccine were successfully produced and released 1968 to 1974. Unfortunately, this manufacturing unit was closed in 1974. No one knows why this has happened. But it was a bad thing. If this unit would have not been closed, we would have not waited to eliminate this disease till January 2011. But this happens, our country is like that. And whenever we discuss any issue of poliomyelitis, we have to take the name of Dr. T. Jacob John. Basically pediatrician, then joined United Kingdom to become infectious disease specialist, and then went to United States of America to become laboratory virologist. He was head of the department of CMC Vellore. He has done great work, and he was the first one to recognize failure of oral polio vaccine. Failure means child was given 3 doses, but still after that child was developing paralysis. This is called failure. And therefore he started vaccinating everybody below 5 years. This was his small plan in Vellore town, then it extended into the south, and then it was applied to the country. Started giving 3 doses, October, November, December, pulsating doses. He is the pioneer of pulse polio in India. To summarize, pathologists in this country should give kudos to themselves, whose work made things to happen for India. They describe epidemiology, pathogenesis, pathology, vaccine efficacy, monitoring and control of existing epidemics. They are our hidden figures who impacted the fight against poliomyelitis. And today I have told you their names. I have also shown some of the photographs of them. To conclude, previous generation of pathologists defined their goals, visions and mission, and work to see that once a deadly crippling disease is eradicated. Current generation need to define the future, leave the world a better place than when they found it. With this, thank you very much for a silently listening to me.
My PG in general medicine, Dr. Ramavatar Sharma, he taught us polio, and you know how many hours? 7 days. Only polio. Why it was done? Because it was one of the important neurological disorders. I still remember unnatural polio, minimum disease, polio affecting adults, not only children, but adults, and how to diagnose polio in such situations. We, at that time I thought, why is he doing this? But today when I have heard him, now I realize that the people who really give everything of their life to save the mankind, they must be rewarded. So everybody should remember Salk vaccine, the Sabin vaccine, injectable, oral, Mr. Bachchan. One who was there?
Bill Gates.
Bill Gates. They are the famous figures. But everyone behind the screen contributed to polio eradication. Maybe a lab technician or a pioneer engineering or a biomedical engineering. All thanks to them, and thank you Dr. Lanjavar for highlighting the importance of eradication.